Thank you for taking the time to join us. We've just got a short discussion piece to go through around digital transformation in defence. So just introduce some people up on the stage. You've got myself, Rob Merriweather. I'm the Group Technology Director for BAE Systems. I'm also going to flip between hopefully providing some insights on digital transformation while also attempting to MC the conversation discussion. So apologies if I'm a little clumsy at elements of that. Have Mibby James from our digital intelligence business, and also delighted to be joined by Matt Pilkington from Microsoft. So, for digital transformation, one of the interesting challenges around this is a topic. It means so many different things to so many different people. You can look at it through so many different lenses. Whether that's the performance that we enable on the platforms and products that you see around the stand through making those data-enabled, software-enabled platforms, whether it's things like the synthetic environments driving into training, product design, that digital thread right the way through the evolution and the life cycle of our products, or whether it's the impact it has on our people, our processes, our ways of working, our ways of operating to make the most of this digital world. There's a number of different perspectives that you can bring to this. So I just want to start really by asking the question of the panel, what does digital transformation defence mean to you, to start to get some insight into those perspectives? So I'll join the seats. We'll start what will hopefully be a fairly informal discussion. But Mibby, digital transformation from your perspective, please.
Thanks, Rob. So for digital transformation, I think it's very important to think about why we need digital transformation before we think about what it is. So we live in a world where the pace of change seems to be ever accelerating, both in terms of technology, but also geopolitical things, as we see from just over on the stand here. And to keep pace with that change and to get ahead, we absolutely need to do digital transformation, to be agile, to be able to exploit technology, and to join up all of those dots. So I always like to focus on the technology, but remember why we need digital transformation in the first place.
Well, thanks, Rob. And maybe I think a brief bit of background, I should say. I've been working in digital transformation for 11 years now. People will detect an Irish accent. I'm from Dublin originally, moved to London about 11 years ago, first with Accenture's public sector strategy and consulting practice, and then more recently with Microsoft in their defense intelligence business. So the only reason I say that is I've spent a lot of time thinking about the what, why, and how of digital transformation for government and then for defense. And I think the other small bit of context I should give is, being part of the worldwide defense intelligence business at Microsoft, you get reasonable visibility of the trends across defense organizations globally. So yes, BAE Systems and the UK Ministry of Defense, but also at NATO, how are they thinking about digital transformation? And I'd absolutely agree with what Mibby said around the why. Why are we doing this? And for me, it's fundamentally about how can we help defense organizations embrace modern tech to get what they need to do, get done faster and more effectively. That's all well and good, but when I think about if we step back for a moment to the pandemic 2 years ago, we saw the NHS workers, 1.4 million of them, adopting Teams in the space of a week. I think what's encouraging is that hasn't slowed down that pace of adoption, that mindset of we can move a lot faster with this tech, we can do remote medical assistance, and we're starting to see that in defense. So for me, it always comes back to, how are we helping the people in defense, the people who are keeping us safe, to get what they need to get done more easily, basically?
Thanks, Matt. And I think for me, my perspective is how pervasive that digital transformation is in everything that we do. There's one level where, if we take the digital design lifecycle of a product, how do we understand how to do that with systems-based model-based systems engineering, with the use of optimization in physics-based models, use of AI in design. There's those kinds of considerations that take us through to how do we develop a product faster. But that digital transformation then becomes, how does that product operated? What's the tactics to deploy it? What's the training mechanisms that you use to define the best tactics? How do you link what you learn from that training and tactics development environment back into the requirements and the features of the product that you look to provide to our customers? And the kind of coalescing of the complexity of that problem space with the pace of change that Mivi was describing, that can only be enabled with a software-enabled world that allows those changes to be propagated through a system really, really quickly. What does digital transformation mean to me in a role as a technology director? It means an awful lot of complexity, and it means bringing that together with both technology and culture and people to change how we work to make the most of that environment. So, to move the conversation on a little bit then, I'll ask some tricky ones of you, Matt, from a kind of a hyperscale technology perspective. What do you see as some of the key differences in either the challenges or the approaches to digital transformation in commercial and defense sectors?
Sure. I think for me, if I might initially focus on two of the biggest opportunities we're seeing in the defense space when we talk about digital transformation within that. Artificial intelligence, of course, it'd be remiss not to mention that, I think, in the year that we're in, and the industrial metaverse for defense. Now, both, I'll admit, if I think initially there's a perception of, particularly with industrial metaverse, is this the preserve of Hollywood and video games? I think I'll be the first to admit I had that view a couple of years ago, but even looking at Project Odyssey, which BAE Systems are showcasing, there was Striker 2, the virtual helmet for pilots that was shown earlier today, and I was frantically taking notes. It was a fantastic demo. We're starting to see that actually playing out, and I think that there's a perception that these things are happening in the private sector and in video games, but actually it's happening in defense and in public sector. So that, to me, I really enjoy challenging people's perceptions on that. But at the same time, I think we're only at the cusp of what's possible there. And we were having some interesting conversations earlier, Rob, about what really could be possible in that mixed reality space. But not wanting to go down too much of a rabbit hole on that, I think that's been my number one observation, is challenging the perception that these emerging tech of AI and mixed reality is only for private sector. I think it's very, very much active and quite exciting in defense.
And maybe where do you think... you're seeing some of those seedlings of progress and that transformation starting to take hold. Talk a little bit about where you see that progress being made and maybe either the challenges or the enablers that will mm-hmm. help take that forwards.
So what I see in defence, having also spent a large chunk of my career in the commercial sector, is that in defence you get these amazing pockets of innovation, but they are pockets. Just look at some of the tech and some of the really cool platforms around us today, and you absolutely get some bleeding edge technology. But the kind of big difference between the defense sector and the commercial sector is the platform of session, I'd say. And so it's quite difficult to think of things in terms of an enterprise scale service models and so on, which is what we're used to seeing in the commercial sector. So it becomes even harder to kind of join up all of those dots. So I think that's the opportunity in defense now, is to move the thinking on from platforms to being more service centric. By service, I mean business services and data services across the whole enterprise, and spend less time worrying about the silos. So whether it's C2 or whether it's intelligence, because really the data and the software doesn't care that much, and it's all connected together as part of that same enterprise.
If I could really briefly build on that, because I'm totally with you on that, and I'd nearly just, it probably lends weight to it as well. The shift, and it's evident in this DSEI being increasingly international, I think we were speaking with that earlier, with the growth of deeper international cooperation, I think the need for, if we look at GCAP and programs like that, or AUKUS, a lot of these international defense cooperation programs, that lends weight for, it seems eminently sensible to take a data-centric and service-centric approach to collaboration and data protection. So moving away from that platform mindset feels very, so I had to just add to that maybe, because it's a brilliant point.
I think, from my perspective, one of the things that I think has really been learned from some of the Ukraine examples and experiences is, one of the adages, and it won't be the first time you've heard it said, is the one thing you know about the next war is it won't be the one that you were expecting. And at the point where you go into battle, the challenges that you face will be different to those that you have prepared for. And when we look at how integration has happened rapidly in Ukraine and in some of those operations, it does come back to the integration is driven by the ability to share data. Now, in some instances, that sharing might still be by somebody reading and, you know, transposing and, you know, passing that on into other areas, which is clearly suboptimal, but it still brings you back to the ability to share data is fundamentally linked to your ability to integrate and therefore deploy new capabilities. So one of the things that, you know, we're spending a lot of time thinking about is what is the most critical data to share? Because whilst the data doesn't care, you know, it doesn't, but the use case that you apply that data to can become critically important. So if I have situational awareness information, is that good enough for me to send a drone to say, please go and look at that location because I think something's going on, you know, give me more information? Or is that piece of data good enough to say, I know exactly what's in that location and I know exactly that it is an enemy force and I'm now going to be prepared to target off that data? So there's a real challenge around the veracity of data and how we get traceability of that. And where I think, you know, you work in contested and constrained environments, so you know, you can't rely on interconnectivity, you can't rely on resilient bandwidth. That drives us to a place where actually we don't want to exchange data, we want to exchange information, because the size of that is so much smaller. But when you drive to exchanging information, you now need to understand how much can I trust that information. So when we talk about, you know, the deployment of AI, if we have, you know, an AI algorithm from, you know, one of our allied forces that is giving us a piece of information that says this is something that you should act on, how do we start to introduce the structures that introduce the level of trust in that artificial intelligence output? Because that trust becomes fundamentally linked to how we can use it and how broadly we can use it. So it's kind of moving on a little bit, maybe down a bit of a technical rabbit hole, but where do you see trusted AI and methods for understanding the purpose of which an information product is useful? Either, you know, solutions or challenges or mm-hmm. just insights into that space.
So to trust the AI, you need to trust the data that it was trained on. And I think there's a bit of a paradox when we look at data in that we want to both look at all of the data irrespective of its provenance and be certain of the provenance of the data, particularly when you're using it for something which I've just called sort of safety critical, mission critical. And so we want to be able to use open source data. I think that's really powerful. But you can't rely on open source data to be representative of everything you want to look at. You know, we all know about bias in data and so on that's just out there on the internet. And you also want to be able to know whether you're looking at something is actually the truth as opposed to a deep fake, etc. But you can't ignore that data. And so this is why we need to have our own kind of sovereign sensors to acquire the data, and then we can kind of almost stamp the data that's acquired through that route for its provenance and mix it with the open source so that when we're training the AI, we know exactly what data it's looking at and how much we trust it. So when we get the algorithms, it can better differentiate when we kind of release that AI into the wild, if you like.
Yeah, and it's so timely because I think in today's Financial Times, the big read is, I think I'll get the title right, of the race to set the rules for AI. And I think, so Microsoft earlier this year published their blueprint for responsible AI. For me, I think if I try to reduce it in fundamental terms, there's the data lineage and data verification technical techniques we can apply, but absolutely there's the regulatory evolution that's needed on this too. So I think out of Brussels this year in EU, we had the AI Act. It was kind of one of the first proactive piece of legislation expected to be signed off this year. But it strikes me how it really is at the cutting edge of innovation here, and regulation absolutely needs to be invested in to stay on top of this, because fundamentally, as you say, as you both made, trust is going to be central to how we responsibly deploy this.
And I think also we need to differentiate between all the different types of AI without going into a whole load of AI nerdiness around that, which I'm sure we'd all love to do. But if you're training the AI and then you're deploying it, that's very different to having iterative AI that's kind of learning once it's deployed, particularly if it's deployed in multiple environments, because you can end up with a version control issue there, because you can end up with inconsistent behaviors depending on where it's actually then being refined. So I think when we look at the kind of governance of AI and how much we trust it, we need to understand exactly what the nature of the beast is and how, whether it's kind of something which has been predefined, so it's only done that pre-learning, or whether it's actually being refined in operational use, both of which are useful, but I think the kind of the governance around those two things needs to be quite different.
Okay, thank you. Can I just check, do we have a mic on the floor? Can we open up to questions? Any questions for, you know, whether it's around the AI elements or just that broader topic of digital transformation for defense?
Is it working? Really interesting conversation, thank you. The people and the culture piece, just could you talk a bit more about that? Because technology is a great enabler. Unless you take people on the journey with you, the technology stays in the cupboard.
Wow. This is a personal view, not necessarily academically endorsed insight. My experience of any of these kind of transformations is showing people value, benefit, and wins. So finding those experimentation environments where we can produce those manageable examples of how working in this way, bringing together whichever element of digital transformation that we're talking about, actually delivers measurable benefit, starts to build the enthusiasm, it starts to build the self-worth of the people who were involved in that experiment, and that starts to build the advocacy from which kind of cultural change can come. For me, for culture change and bringing people along, I'm a big advocate for start small and manageable, but once you achieve something small and manageable, propagate and advertise those successes really, really well. And then through that, start to get that perception, that visibility, that reality that they're the things that people want to be involved with, because the experience of the people who did the initial activities was positive, it was enjoyable, it was rewarding. For me, culture change is all about start small, but then advertise big.
I think it's a great question, because people are key to any type of transformation. So I'm a computer scientist, and I now find myself spending almost all of my time doing people stuff, which is horrifying. And because the leadership and the culture and the digital, not just for digital transformation, but any type of change, is much harder than the technical stuff, I'd say. I'm not saying technical stuff's easy, but technical problems are always solvable eventually with the right time and the right kind of skills and the right resources and so on, but people are inherently tricky to deal with, and we live in a culture which has rewarded a particular set of behaviours which are almost the opposite of agile. I think hide behind the process, decision by committee because that feels safe, and all of those types of things. And when you're working in, almost deliberately muddle up agile and digital transformation. But if you're being nimble, if you're being an agile organization, you've got to give people proper autonomy. You've got to delegate those responsibilities, but you've got to give them the safety. You can't delegate that authority and then blame them. And at the moment, in most organizations, I still think it's much safer to kind of go, well, it wasn't me, the process said I couldn't do it. To ask 10 people, and if one person says no, then everybody breathes a sigh of relief, because then the overall answer becomes no. So move towards kind of democratic decision making rather than decision by consensus will help speed that pace of change. But pace of change, I think, is quite scary, and it can feel like you're going alone. So leadership is absolutely essential. So so this computer scientist spends a lot of time talking about leadership culture and how we need to shift that and be genuine about it and make fail fast a psychologically safe thing.
Yeah, and I'll just add to that, I think, because it's a brilliant question, close to my heart as well. And I think this is where, to Mivy's point earlier, around pockets of innovation in defense are happening really well. I think the same can be true of this in terms of excellent adoption and change management and parts where we can learn better. I think there's three things I often come back to of kind of how to do this well. Work in the open, which is kind of what Rob has mentioned. Multidisciplinary teams, so involve your end users from the start. I was at a brilliant stand at the Defence Medical Services the other day, and medics were showing me the medical apps that they've designed. So it's for medics, by medics, being used in the field. But also include security and compliance in the team at the start so that we can identify blockers at the beginning. So, and in that way, your designers become your change advocates because they've designed it. So working in the open. And then the last one I would say is, building on what's been discussed, you'll often hear me say, at least, let's think big, start small, learn and scale quickly. And I think we certainly have experienced that working with BAE Systems in certain departments and teams and elsewhere in UK Defence. But I think that's really a key to snowball effect, I think, how Rob has described it. So, yeah, great question.
Thank you. Any more questions? No? Well, I think in that case, I hope you found some of what we were talking about interesting. And thank you very much for coming. And I hope you enjoy the rest of the show. Thank you.